Well, hello everyone and welcome to the Harwell Campus. It's a real delight to see you all here today. I'm Karina, I'm from the Harwell and Chilton Churches and I also work on site. And we've organised this lecture here tonight with John Lennox, which we're all, well, I hope we're all really looking forward to. I've got to say I am. I could do my hair air hostess bit. I've done a little bit on the door and there's a little bit more to do. If the fire alarm goes off, the fire bell will ring. We're not expecting a practice, so it is for real. The fire exits are either side at the bottom here, and if you go up the stairs and out to your right, you'll find the other fire exit. The meeting point, I believe, is the Diamond car park, but I'll get there first, so I'll meet you there. We are on the Harwell campus, so there is a klaxon alarm. That's if something goes wrong in the Harwell, in the Harwell site. If that goes off, we just stay here and keep going. If that goes off and the fire alarm goes off, my boss always says, choose your way to die. The idea is that you leave the burning building and enter the nearest not burning building. And everything else I think we know, but you can read it up behind us. There are toilets here. If you go through where we had the buffet, head towards the door and take a right, if you're going from this direction, the toilets are on your left down there. So, just a little bit to introduce our speaker tonight and to introduce what we're doing. This is the inaugural lecture for the Crossing the Gap series. We're hoping to have three lectures here on matters of science and faith. Crossing the Gap is funded by a grant from the World Templeton Charity Foundation via the Scientists in Congregations project, if you want to look us up. We have a fabulous first speaker in Professor John Lennox. He is an Emeritus Professor of Mathematics at Oxford University and a Fellow in Mathematics and Philosophy at Green Templeton College, Oxford. I have a great long list of qualifications. He started his life in Emmanuel College at Cambridge and has latterly transferred over to Oxford. Among many qualifications in mathematics, he also has an MA in bioethics from the University of Surrey. And he's written a number of books on issues of science and faith and is one of the world experts. Some of his books are on sale here tonight or available via your nearest good bookshop. I reassure you, Amazon does sell them, much to my relief. I thought I'd add a few other little strings to John's bow. Amongst all these wonderful qualifications in maths and in ethics, he speaks Russian, French, and German, and allegedly, according to Wikipedia, enjoys astronomy and bird watching. So I give you John Lennox, our speaker tonight.
Ladies and gentlemen, one time I was being introduced with a CV like this, and it was said that I was interested in amateur bird watching. The very first question from the audience was, what is an amateur bird? It's a great honor for me, and indeed it's a great sign of your grace, to invite me to an institution like this, which is famous for its work in physics, because I am a pure mathematician. And it's obvious that those that invited me did not look up the definition of a pure mathematician. A pure mathematician is someone who talks in other people's sleep. But I hope not to fit into that stereotype tonight. Our topic is cosmic chemistry, do science and God mix. It is a huge topic and it has engaged me most of my life, almost since childhood. And because to every speaker there belongs a biography, it's sometimes helpful just to say a little bit to explain to you where I'm coming from. Now, geographically, that ought already to be obvious. Dubious reputation when it comes to the God quest. remarkable people. They were Christian, but they were not sectarian. And that was quite difficult in those days. And they showed that lack of sectarianism by, in my father's store, employing people across the religious divide. We were bombed for that, so terrorism hit our home. The second thing I owe to my parents is that they allowed me space to think. And that was not a common thing in my country, I regret to say. There was so much entrenched opinion. And I'm so grateful that when I got to Cambridge in 1962, I'd been encouraged by my parents to read extremely widely and to consider worldviews other than Christian. And so what my life has been about has been determined to a certain extent by what happened very early on in my studies at Cambridge. Two events in particular. The first was when I was at dinner and an undergraduate asked me rather too loudly, in my opinion, he said, "Do you believe in God? Do you go to church?" And then he said, "Oh, sorry, you're Irish. I should have realized that." All you Irish believe in God and you fight about it. Now, of course, I'd heard that many times before, but it pierced my mind like an arrow because I thought, this is the Freudian objection, of course. It's that Irish genetics accounts for everything, your parents Christian, your grandparents, and so on. There's nothing more to it than that. And I made a decision that day to befriend people who came from the diametrically opposite position to my own. So I deliberately searched around the group of students for atheists and agnostics, befriended them, and I spent my entire life doing precisely that. And I mean befriended. I wanted to know why they thought what they thought. And since my parents had taught me the basic moral principle that has lived with me all my life, that all people, whatever they believe, are of infinite value because they're made in the image of God, I therefore took what people thought seriously, and I still do very much. So that was the first incident. The second was more threatening. I was sitting at dinner and I found myself beside a Nobel Prize winner. I'd never met a Nobel Prize winner before, and I didn't really know what to say, so I asked a few questions. I've learned that playing Socrates is one of the most interesting things to do in life. I started asking questions, and one of them was a God question, and he didn't like it, so I backed off. But at the end of the meal, he said, "Lennox, I want you to come to my study." And he invited three other professors, full professors at Cambridge. And they stood around me while they asked me to sit on a chair. And then he said, "Lennox, do you want a career in science?" I said, "Yes, sir." "Okay, then," he said, "in front of witnesses tonight, give up this childish faith in God." I tell you, that was pressure. And I looked at him. I didn't really know what to say. But in the end, I said, "Sir, what have you got to offer me that's better than what I've got?" And he mentioned the work of Bergson, and I fortunately had read some of the work of Bergson, and I said, "If you don't mind, I will take the risk." But that put steel into my heart, because that was force majeure. If it had been the other way round, and they had been Christian and I had been an atheist, it would have caused reverberations through the entire university. It taught me a very big lesson, that there are forces at work, sadly, among some of our leading thinkers, that feel that science and God just do not mix, and that you have to choose between science and God. Now, I want to simply go through some of the arguments that have been important to me. And I would like to suggest that as I go through, you've got a piece of paper, I hope, that you write down a question. It's much easier when they're written. We will then have 5 minutes or so space at the end. I will go through them briefly and collect them together and answer as many as I can. But do be thinking of a question as I speak to you. the pictures that you're looking at, they're not very good, but on the left-hand side, you see the Natural History Museum in Oxford, and on the top right is Richard Dawkins and myself discussing this very question. The bottom scene is a very bored-looking Christopher Hitchens, obviously disagreeing profoundly, as he did with what I was saying in a lecture and a debate in America. And I've been privileged in my life to have the opportunity to talk about these things in public with the leading atheists, of whom, of course, the world leader is probably still Richard Dawkins. I want to suggest, though, that the popular idea that science and God do not mix is simply not true. And I think it's relatively easy to establish. Since we are in an institute geared to physics, let's go to the Physics Nobel Prize. Steven Weinberg won it. He is an atheist. Charles Townes won it. He was a Christian. Now, what divides these men is not their science. They both won the Physics Nobel Prize. So there's no distinction to be made on the basis of their science. The difference between them, of course, lies in their worldviews. One is an atheist, the other is a Christian. And it actually surprised me to find out, on examining the Nobel Prizes for the Natural Sciences from 1900 to 2000, over 60% of the Nobel Prize winners apparently believed in God. That doesn't prove anything. But what this proves or establishes is the naive view that if you're a brilliant scientist, you can't believe in God. Or if you're a brilliant scientist, you can't be an atheist. Both of those statements are false. And the important thing, I think, is this. What we have is not a clash between science and God, but we do have a clash. And it's between worldviews, the atheistic worldview and the theistic worldview, in my case, Christian. Now, there are other worldviews, but those will do us for this evening. So the real question to be faced is, where does science fit in this picture? Does science point towards naturalism, atheism, as Richard Dawkins would claim? Or does it point nowhere? Is it neutral? Or does it point, as I would argue, towards theism? And I'm going to consider that and examine the evidence for it. But before going into that, one of the things I've observed often is that science, quite rightly, has enormous cultural authority in our society. And that's perfectly right. But the problem with that is that statements by scientists are often taken as statements of science and invested with that authority. Let me give you a very simple example of that. Stephen Hawking, who is just ahead of me at Cambridge and light years ahead of me in his intellectual ability, he told, I think it was the Times, religion is a fairy story for those afraid of the dark. Now, there's a scientist making a statement, but it isn't a statement of science. And just for the record, I was asked by the same newspaper to comment on it. And I said, do you want a one-line comment like this one? They said, oh, we'd love that. So I said, all right, for what it's worth, atheism is a fairy story for those afraid of the light. Now, you shouldn't actually laugh, because if you've been listening carefully, I pointed out it's simply a statement of Hawking's belief, not of science, as was my reply. It doesn't prove anything. It's simply a statement of personal belief. And to get beyond that, you have to ask the evidence question. Why do you believe that? And evidence-based faith is the center not only of my science, it's the center of my Christianity. Now, I want to unpack that just a little bit. What about the sources of evidence? Now, of course, being a pure mathematician, I will not use the word proof, Proof in English and most other languages has got two fairly distinct meanings. The first is the strict, rigorous, logical one. Start with these axioms, use these arguments, and you get your conclusion. You only get that in pure mathematics. You don't get it in physics. You don't get it in any other of the natural sciences. There you can talk about evidence, pointers, and that evidence can be immensely powerful. Do you believe in the Higgs boson? Yes, because here is the evidence that was discovered around the world, and so on. And I mention that because it is important to see that lack of proof in the mathematical sense does not mean either lack of rigor or lack of convicting power. Simple example, I fly quite regularly around the world. And so to travel, I have to trust, I have to have faith in a Boeing 747. I cannot prove that it's going to get me there in a mathematical sense. But I have enough experience and enough evidence, cumulative evidence, to trust it. Another example, I've been married for 48 years to the same person, but I can't prove to you mathematically that she loves me. But I'd risk my life on it. Do you get the point? That just because we don't have mathematical rigor doesn't mean we cannot have evidence enough to base our life's decisions and even risk our life. We trust medical doctors. We have faith in them. So having said that, we then would ask the question as to the sources of evidence. Where can we get evidence on this question as to whether science and God mix? I want to suggest that there are three main sources. Firstly, the history of science. Secondly, the nature and philosophy of science. And only thirdly, the results of science. That comes as a surprise to many people because they think that people like me who believe in God will point to some scientific thing, phenomenon, and say, well, that couldn't possibly have come about by this or that process, therefore there must be a God. There is a place for arguments, I believe, from the results of science. But far more importantly, in my view, and hence the order, is to look first of all at the history and secondly at the nature and philosophy, and then and only then at some of the results of science. I shall be concentrating largely on the first two, and one of the most important things under category two will be the fact that we can do science. And I shall explain the significance of that as I go on. What about the rise of modern science? And I stress the word modern in the 16th and 17th centuries. C.S. Lewis, summarizing the work of Sir Alfred North Whitehead, put it succinctly. Men became scientific because they expected law in nature, and they expected law in nature because they believed in a lawgiver. Now that is a thesis, sometimes called Merton's thesis and other names, that is widely accepted with various nuances by people like John Hedley Brooke or Peter Harrison, who were the past two professors of science and religion in Oxford. And if you look at the pioneers, starting with Galileo and proceeding through the really famous one, let's just stop with one of my favorites, Kepler, because I love astronomy, the chief aim of all investigations of the external world should be to discover the rational order which has been imposed on it by God and which he revealed to us in the language of mathematics. Or Isaac Newton, don't doubt the creator, because it is inconceivable that accidents alone could be the controller of this universe. So the first interesting point to my mind, and it's much more than a straw in the wind, is that far from belief in God hindering science, it was the motor that drove it. Because these people believed in a rational creator, and they therefore anticipated a universe that is accessible, at least in part, by the human mind. So there's a strong connection between faith in God and science. Hence, the universities of Cambridge and Oxford and hundreds of other universities around the world. The people that founded them saw no disparity in intellectual activity and faith in God. In fact, the two went hand in hand. Now, that's simply a fact of history, and it's a very important one. Let me put it very sharply, really. I'm not remotely embarrassed at being a scientist, that is, if you allow a pure mathematician to describe himself like that, of course, and a Christian, because arguably it was Christianity gave me my subject. And now we're going to focus this very sharply indeed, because to get into the debate, there was Newton, absolutely brilliant, one of the towering intellects of science in any age. He held a chair at Cambridge, and the generations passed until that chair was held by Stephen Hawking. Stephen Hawking, genius that he is, announced some time ago, as you see in the Times, that God did not create the universe. Physics has no need of God, and he declared himself to be an atheist. Now that raises a very interesting question. Isaac Newton, who discovered the law of gravity, a believer in God. Stephen Hawking, whose work is on gravitation, doesn't believe in God. And even more interestingly, their arguments in both directions depend on gravity to a certain extent. When Newton wrote his Principia Mathematica, arguably the most famous book in the history of science, he expressed explicitly the hope that it would lead the thinking person to believe in a deity. What a genius of a God who worked in this way and who set in the universe a law of gravity. And now comes Stephen Hawking, and he uses gravity as an argument not to believe in God. I quote the central argument from his book, co-authored with Leonard Mlodinow, The Grand Design. Because there is a law of gravity, the universe can and will create itself from nothing. That is the key argument of that best-selling book. This helps me focus the problem. How do we get from Newton to Hawking? What are the differences? What can help us understand why there's a huge shift in what's going on here? So here's the dilemma. Isaac Newton, discoverer of the law of gravitation, believed in God. Stephen Hawking, who occupied Newton's chair at Cambridge, uses gravity as a reason not to believe in God. And there's the quote. So the problem is this. How do we get from Newton's theism to Hawking's atheism? And I want to suggest to you that it does have some basis in confusion and false ideas about the nature of scientific explanation. But before we go into that, it struck me a few years ago that part of the problem in the debate is false ideas about the nature of God. But before I say anything about that, when I first read that explanation, because there is a law of gravity, the universe can and will create itself from nothing, I was asked to comment on it, and I actually wrote a book about it. Because I was so amazed at its lack of inner logic. Because there is a law of gravity, because there is something, the universe can and will create itself from nothing. That's a flat contradiction. Secondly, because there is a law of gravity, not because gravity exists. Now, this opens a window into a very common confusion, but I'm very surprised that Hawking was subject to it. And that is that laws do the creating. I once had a little spat, I suppose you could call it, but it was friendly, with Peter Atkins, a professor of physical chemistry at Oxford. And I said to him, Peter, what created the universe? And without hesitation, he said, mathematics. And I'm afraid I did what some of you have just done. I laughed, and it was not very polite. And he said, why are you laughing? Well, I said, Peter, I must be honest, that's the most absurd thing I've ever heard in my life. And he said, why? Well, I said, look, 1 + 1 = 2. Did that ever put £2 in your pocket? C.S. Lewis pointed out long ago what must be obvious, that laws don't create anything. You who work in physics here know that Newton's laws of motion never moved a billiard ball in the history of the universe. People with Qs do that. The laws describe the motion and predict what will happen, etc., etc., subject to certain boundary conditions. But they are not causes, nor are they creative. Indeed, I reflect somewhat sadly on the financial crisis, which has affected us all, and I suspect that part of the difficulty there was that some people think, or thought, that mathematics can create money. Do enough calculating and so on, and you get money. That's what they thought, and they were wrong. So there's a fundamental flaw here in what the status of law is. But it's even worse than that, it seems to me. The universe will create itself from nothing. Now, there are two assertions there. First of all, the universe will create itself. If I say to you, X creates Y, what does that mean? Well, roughly, if you've got X, you'll get Y. And if I say, X creates X, what does that mean? Well, it means, roughly, if you've got X, you'll get X. And what does that mean? Well, it seems to me to mean that nonsense remains nonsense, even if high-powered scientists are writing it. It is sheer nonsense. What is more serious, perhaps, is the contention that they have solved the basic problem of Leibniz, why there is something rather than nothing. Now, you may want to ask me about that, because one of my joys and delights these days is to give lectures entitled Nothing. Nothing is such a fascinating topic. Now that people have invested it with all kinds of curious notions that take us way far away from our common understanding of the word and have therefore felt that the universe can be produced from nothing, I'm perfectly happy to address that question. But looking at this as a statement that's the key argument in his book, I just was staggered because it falls down on at least three different levels of self-contradiction. So let's go over to the other side. How do we shift from Newton's theism to Hawking's atheism? Well, I want to suggest to you that the first notion problem is false ideas about the nature of God. And I'm sure in an institution like this, you've all seen this slide of the two scientists, and there's wonderful equations on the left-hand side and wonderful equations on the right. And in the middle it says, then a miracle occurs. And one scientist said, I think you should be more explicit here in step two. The point being, there's a gap, and it's filled with a concept of the supernatural. Now, just thinking about that, what struck me some years ago is that many of the people that I dialogue with, that is exactly what they think God is like. A god of the gaps, like the Greek god of lightning. In other words, to put it very simply, I can't explain it, therefore God did it. Now, if you take that view of God, of course, it's obvious that as science advances, that kind of god disappears. Yes? Now, try and follow this, because it seems to me very important in understanding what's going on. If you define God to be a god of the gaps, then you've got to choose between God and science, because that's how you've defined God. But you see, the God I believe in is not a god of the gaps. You may have noticed, if you've ever read that ancient book, in the beginning God created the bits of the universe that we don't yet understand. No, that's not how it starts. It starts with, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That in Hebrew is a merism, everything. In other words, the God of the Bible is the God of the whole show. He's not the God of the bits we don't yet understand. He's the God of all of it, whether we understand it or not. And interestingly enough, the reasons for believing in such a God from a scientific perspective generally come from the bits we do understand. It was when Newton discovered the law of gravitation that he just was amazed at this, Just think of that, an equation with eight symbols in it that enables us to plot the courses of the planets to a very high degree of accuracy. And Newton admired the genius of a God who did it that way. And when you think about it, if you're working on the physics of elementary particles here and you discover something and are just simply fascinated by the way it all works, the more you discover, the more you can admire the genius of whatever is behind it. Not the less. The more you know of art, the more you admire the genius of a Rubens. Not the less. The more you understand of engineering, the more you can admire the genius of a Rolls or a Royce. Not the less. And therefore, my view of this is very simple. God is the God of the whole show. And the more I understand about what's going on, the more I can admire his genius for being responsible for it. So that's the first thing. The God of the gaps is not the God of the Bible. But unfortunately, many of the leading thinkers, Dawkins, Hawking, and so on, thinks that that is what I as a Christian believe. And so they say to the public, you've got to choose between God and science. Well, if God is a God of the gaps, they're absolutely right. And so my conclusion on that is stated in that sentence. The God of the Bible is God of the whole show. So, narrowing that down a bit, and that will lead us a bit later, so just let's focus on it for a moment. The two beginning statements in the Bible. In the beginning was the Word. All things came to be through him, and without him nothing came to be that came to be. That's introducing a new concept, not simply God, but the idea of logos, the reason behind the universe, information, command, and so on. We'll come to that in a moment. So let's now look at the question of the second half of this. And it all revolves around, what do we mean by explanation? Dawkins, in his book, The God Delusion, says that God is the same kind of explanation as the scientific explanation. Well, before we go into that, let's just have a look at what we mean by explanation. I was taught the law of gravitation at school, and I was so excited when I first discovered it. And generations of undergraduates later, I taught how to derive the planetary orbits from it and so on. But what they didn't tell me at school was that the law of gravitation does not explain gravity. No one today knows what gravity is yet. And if you don't agree with me, I've consulted Richard Feynman and many other physicists. Nobody knows what gravity is. We can measure its effect. We've all sorts of equations and so on, but we don't know what it is. And it was Ludwig Wittgenstein who made this very interesting comment. The great delusion of modernity is that the laws of nature explain the universe for us. The laws of nature describe the universe. They describe its regularities, but they explain nothing. And Newton realized that, non fingo hypothesi, I don't make hypotheses. That is, I am not professing to explain this completely. And here's the irony of this. Even within science, to simply claim that we have a law, which is marvelous, doesn't mean we've got an explanation. And that's a fatal mistake that people make, because they then say, ah, well, we've got a law, we've got an explanation, we don't need anything else. So that's the first point. The second point is to look at something very simple in physics, if you will forgive me. Why is the water boiling? Well, because the heat energy from the Bunsen flame is being conducted through the copper base of the kettle, and that's agitating the molecules of water, and that's why it's boiling. Well, is it? I really think it's boiling because I'd very much like a cup of tea. Now, your laughter tells something. What does your laughter tell me? That I'm saying something silly. Because I'm saying that the first explanation is false and the second is true. But that's not so. They're both true. But they're different kinds of explanation. The one is in terms of science, heat, physics. The other is in terms of personal agency and intention. I want a cup of tea. Now, it's obvious, surely, that those explanations neither conflict nor do they compete. They complement one another. And if you ask the additional question, which of the two is the more important? Well, people have been drinking tea for centuries before they knew anything about heat in terms of physics. Could the universe be like that? You see, those two explanations don't compete, but they're very different. And if we look at them, we see they're both necessary, they complement and so on, and the personal is more important than the scientific. Now let me extrapolate. It's a very simple argument. Newton's law of gravitation no more competes with God as an explanation of the universe than the law of internal combustion competes with Henry Ford as an explanation of a motor car engine. Do you see that? There's the personal side, the inventor side, Henry Ford, and there is the physics of the situation. They don't compete. And so this idea that it's God or science is totally wrong-headed, because the God explanation is not even in the same philosophical category as the science explanation. They are in different categories, and so they can complement. Richard Swinburne, a colleague at Oxford, a philosopher, says, "I do not deny that science explains, but I postulate God to explain why science explains. The very success of science in showing us how deeply orderly the natural world is provides strong grounds for believing that there's an even deeper cause for that order." Now, we're not quite finished with explanation yet, because when I was at school, I was taught that real explanation always proceeds from the simple to the complex. That is, you explain a complex thing in terms of an analysis into simpler parts. And Richard Dawkins uses this as a major argument against God. He says, using God as an explanation is absurd, since God is by definition more complex than the thing you're explaining. Well, that sounds very impressive until you apply it to his own writings, as I did. I pick up a book called The God Delusion. It's quite complex. It's about 400 pages long. So I ask about its origin. And somebody informs me that it actually originates in the infinitely more complex mind of Richard Dawkins. And I say, that's impossible. That's not an explanation, because Richard Dawkins' mind is more complex than the thing you're explaining. Well, that's ridiculous. You would never allow that to stand. Now, the important thing is to realize why it doesn't work. And it doesn't work because there's a semiotic dimension in the thing that you're explaining. It involves language. And that could be computer language, it could be genetic language, it could be natural language. And one of the reasons I did mathematics, I suppose, is because it's the most highly compressed language we've got. But you've heard I'm very interested in natural languages. Let's have a look at this, because of its sheer importance in the current debate. It's wonderful when you can get a reductionist explanation. That is, you take something very complex and you can reduce it to simpler constituents, and you can see how the complexity develops. But language is somewhere that creates great difficulty. And I'll just illustrate this by a story. You may have heard this if you've listened to me on the internet, but it's a story that illustrates it. In my college at Oxford, like all other colleges, we have nice dinners. And one of the problems, it's not always a problem, is the assignation of places. And one night, I found myself sitting with someone I didn't know, and they asked the usual Oxford question, "What do you do?" You know, when people are introduced to one another, it's very interesting to do an experiment and say, introduce yourself to each other without telling people what you do. It creates a completely different sociological dynamic, but I'm not going to be diverted onto that. "What do you do?" "I'm a pure mathematician." "Oh dear," he said, "how dreadfully boring." "Well," I said, "I understand that my subject is a little bit socially a recondite, but then I try to make up for that, you know, by being interested in some of the big questions. He said, what big questions? Well, I said, the status of the universe, for example, is it created or not? Oh, he said, stop, it's even worse than I thought. He said, listen, I'm an atheist, I'm a reductionist, we've nothing to talk about, and we're going to have a really miserable evening. Well, that's a nice challenge, you know. And I said, you're a reductionist. He said, yes. Well, I said, so am I. He said, are you? I said, sure. I know of at least three different kinds of reductionism. Which kind are you? I'm a methodological reductionist. I take a big problem, split it into little problems, get some insight, and hope I can solve the big problem. He said, I do that too. I said, well, then we can agree on that, and we can talk this evening. But he said, that's not what I mean. I said, I know it isn't what you mean. But at least we got a common discourse we can have. He said, no, I am an ontological reductionist. The Greek word ontos meaning being. He said, look, the bottom line is everything can be brought down to physics and chemistry. I said, really? I said, oh, well, this is a fascinating thing we could discuss. I said, would you like to do an experiment? He said, what? He said, at the dinner table. I said, sure, this is Oxford. He said, okay, let's do an experiment. So I picked up the menu. And he started reading it, roast chicken, you see, this kind of thing. And he said, what's the problem? I said, none from where I sit. But I said, you said roast chicken, what does that mean? Well, he said, it means that he started to explain. Oh, I said, so those marks on the paper have meaning. Yes, he said, of course they have. This is English. I said, how do you know that? Well, he said, I've learned English independently of these marks in the paper. Okay, good, I said, here's the experiment. You say everything can be reduced to physics and chemistry. Yes, he said. I said, all right, explain to me the semiotics of those marks, the way they carry the meaning, using only the physics and chemistry of the paper and ink. There was a little silence. And his wife, dear soul, rather too loudly said, get out of that if you can. I say that, ladies and gentlemen, with no malice, because what he then said was stunning. I'd never heard it before. And remember, this is a world leader of one of the most important labs in the world in his field. He said, it can't be done. I said, pardon? And I played devil's advocate, which is often very easy for an Irishman, you know. I said, but physics and chemistry have only been running for 600 years or so. He said, it doesn't matter. You can't do it. You need a mind. I nearly said to him, a mind of the gaps? Oh, no, it's not a mind of the gaps. It's the nature of the physical situation that you have meaning encoded on matter that tells you that you need a mind. You can't do it simply in terms of physics and chemistry. And he looked at me for a long time, and I began to see what he was thinking. You're not clever enough to have thought of that argument. I said, no, I'm not at all. I got it from a Nobel Prize winner. Oh, he said, what a relief. And I quoted to him Roger Sperry, who won the Nobel Prize for medicine. The meaning of the message will not be found in the physics and chemistry of the paper and ink. But we didn't stop there. You see, he studied this. So I gently said to him, I said, you study a word, don't you? He said, yes, I do. I said, how long is it? 3.5 billion letters in the chemical code. Oh, I said, that's very interesting. Has it got a meaning? Well, yes, in that sense, it's semiotic. It codes for the proteins and so on. And what about its ultimate origin? Oh, he said, chance and necessity. I said, pardon? Do you mean chance and the laws of nature? He said, yes. But I said, half a minute. 5 minutes ago, you saw a five-letter word. And because it contained meaning, because it had a semiotic dimension, you immediately postulated a mind. Why don't you do it here? Whatever physical processes are involved in the genesis of this, there's something extra, isn't there? Well, he didn't really know what to say. And I find that many scientists do not know what to say. I'm not claiming that no physical processes are involved. Of course they are. but there's something there that is not material. Which now brings me to the final little part of our evening. Thinking about thinking. Mathematics and the mind. And one of the greatest minds was Alfred Einstein, who was clever enough to see that there was something mysterious about the comprehensibility of the universe. Eugen Wigner, Nobel Prize for Physics, like Einstein, the enormous usefulness of mathematics is something bordering on the mysterious. There is no rational explanation for it. The miracle of the appropriateness of the language of mathematics for the formulation of the laws of physics is a wonderful gift which we neither understand nor deserve. And I was taught quantum physics at Cambridge by Professor Sir John Polkinghorne, who often points out in his books, physics is powerless to explain its fundamental belief in the mathematical intelligibility of the universe. And what those three eminent scientists are pointing out is, physics is a faith-based endeavor. If you do not believe that physics can be done, you'll never do physics. If you do not believe that the universe is at least in part accessible by the human mind, you will never do physics. You have a credo to start with. That is why it is such a sad thing to my mind that the new atheists, so-called, led by Dawkins, have redefined faith as a religious concept, which means believing where there's no evidence. That is doubly and very dangerously wrong, because faith is essential in science. Einstein said, I cannot imagine a scientist without that faith. He didn't mean faith in God. He meant faith in the rational intelligibility of the universe. Now let me focus this again rapidly. I sometimes ask my colleagues what they do science with. And of course, if they're physicists, they love to tell me about the billion-dollar cyclotron they've just had put in their backyard, you know, and tell me all. I said, no, I don't mean that. I mean, oh, they say, you mean, and they're just about to say mind, where they remember that it's not PC to say mind. They say, you mean my brain. Well, I said, okay, I do actually believe there are profound distinctions between mind and brain, but we won't go into that. Let me just accept your view. You do it with your brain, your science. Tell me about the brain. A brief history of the brain. And they usually come out with something like this. Well, the brain is in the end, it's a lump of meat, and it's the end product of a mindless, unguided process. And I look at them. And I say, and you trust it? And they look at me quizzically. I say, look, be honest with me. If you knew that your computer was the end product of a mindless, unguided process, would you use it? And the answer has always been no. Now I say, please explain to me what's going on. This is what you really believe about the brain. That is the end product of mindless processes. I said, that creates a big worry in my mind. But it's a worry which I share with none less than Charles Darwin. And I remind them of Darwin's doubt. With me, the horrid doubt always arises whether the convictions of man's mind, which has been developed from the mind of the lower animals, are of any value or at all trustworthy. He saw the problem. But he's not the only one who's seeing the problem. An increasing range of very powerful thinkers in our world, some of them atheists, some not. Here is John Gray, an atheist. Modern humanism is the faith, notice please the word, that through science humankind can know the truth and so be free. But if Darwin's theory of natural selection is true, this is impossible. The human mind serves evolutionary success, not truth. Now, Alvin Plantinga, one of the world's leading philosophers from Notre Dame in America, if Dawkins is right that we are the product of mindless, unguided natural processes, then he has given us strong reason to doubt the reliability of human cognitive faculties, and therefore inevitably to doubt the validity of any belief that they produce, including Dawkins' own atheism. Now, this argument is developing. I first came across it many years ago in the writings of C.S. Lewis, who pointed out that We've done brilliant science by thinking, but we haven't focused enough attention on thinking. And he says any theory that invalidates thinking must be ruled out of court automatically because you reached it by thinking. And he sowed that seed in my mind that has come to fruition in more recent years. And what I'm very interested in seeing, ladies and gentlemen, is I'm observing this argument moving into the center of this whole God and science debate. And in particular, under Thomas Nagel. Thomas Nagel is an American philosopher. He's a hard atheist. On his own confession, he doesn't simply not believe in God. He doesn't want there to be a God and says so. He has written a book which has the most explosive subtitle of any book I've seen in my life. There is the title and the subtitle. Mind and Cosmos: Why the Neo-Darwinian View of the World is Almost Certainly False. This has caused absolute chaos in atheistic cyberspace, as you can imagine. It's a very interesting thesis, and the heart of his argument is the one I've just developed. It's we do our thinking, and we've got to trust the mind. But trusting the mind has developed theories that undermine any validity of what the mind produces. And so he writes very honestly. He doesn't see a way out, but here's what he writes. If the mental is not itself merely physical, it cannot be fully explained by physical science. Evolutionary naturalism implies that we shouldn't take any of our convictions seriously, including the scientific world picture on which evolutionary naturalism itself depends. And so I suggest to you that science and God do mix very well, but it's science and atheism don't mix very well. And that is becoming increasingly evident in my view. Atheism, as far as I can see, ultimately undermines the validity of the very rational processes that we need, not only for science, but any thinking whatsoever. So my conclusion is science and God do mix. And ironically, we have lived to the information age. Now, I could start another lecture at this point, but I'm not going to do so. But ladies and gentlemen, is it not very interesting that physicists are increasingly regarding information as a quantity, quality, entity, whatever you call it, that is not reducible to physics and chemistry? They also observe that Landauer's thesis is false. He said information is physical in a famous paper. But as an Oxford Don has recently pointed out in a very convincing book, that is not what he meant. He meant that information is mostly carried on physical carriers. It itself is invisible, and it's immaterial. So the irony of 21st century physics is we are now relying more and more on investigating a space of immaterial and abstract things that we call information. And indeed, some physicists, as you probably know, go so far as to say that it's the information that is fundamental. The fundamental entity of information is the bit. And one of the arguments is that matter is quantized and energy is quantized because information is quantized. So it is bit before it rather than it before bit, as the famous article put it. Now, of course, this is an immensely complex subject, and it fascinates me as a pure mathematician, but I realize how difficult it is. But what I find so interesting is this, that the Bible, which says relatively little on how things came to be, has put its finger on the central issues that interest us as scientists and thinkers today. In the beginning was the Word. All things came to be through him. What is that saying? It's saying that information, energy, God the Word, a personal source of information and energy, is primary. All things came to be through him, including mass energy. That is, mass energy are derivative. Now perhaps you can see the fundamental clash between the two worldviews. Because the common worldview I meet is, in the beginning was nothing. And nothing produced everything. And produced the idea of God because there isn't a God. That is the diametrical opposite pole. Of course, each of us has to make up our mind which of those two views is intellectually the more convincing. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Now I suggest as rapidly as possible you get some questions up here and we'll have a go at as many of them as we can. So if you want to stand up and just take a very quick break, please do so. Or leave if the number 9 bus is going right now.
We're almost ready to answer those questions now. Hopefully John's had a chance to read them all and process them into fantastic answers for you all.
Now you're about to find out the depths of my ignorance, ladies and gentlemen. This is a Q&A. Now, what is a Q&A? A Q&A is a very inadequate process for a very simple reason. I have just seen these questions, and I haven't even had time to read them all. So what are you going to get? You're going to get something very superficial, which is my instant reaction to the questions. But that's not bad, you see, because if you have brought a question tonight, the far more important thing is the work you will do afterwards in getting an answer that really satisfies you, if it's a genuine question. So I'm not going to appear to be the fount of all knowledge. I shall probably prove to be the pit of all ignorance. But we'll have a go. I love these times because they force me to think. So here goes. By your grace, were the founders of modern science not obligated by the social context, Christian, to ground their thinking in Christian terms? The question is perfectly legitimate. And Richard Dawkins actually asked me it in public. And he said, look, everybody in those days believed in Christianity, so there's no big deal that the founders of modern science were theistic and Christian. And I said, everybody, not everybody. What about the Chinese, or quite a few of them? And the interesting thing about the Chinese is that although they developed technology, printing, fireworks, and various kinds of engineering devices, they never developed any kind of abstract science. Now, why is that interesting? It's interesting because a lot of research was done on it by Joseph Needham, the chemist, who was also a sinologist. And he spent years trying to fit this apparent discrepancy between East and West into his own neo-Marxist philosophy. And in the end, he couldn't. And he said, admitted in the end, that the only difference I can see between East and West is that the East did not have the concept of a single creator who created the universe to run on laws that would be describable mathematically. So you do have it in both directions. It's not an arbitrary connection, although, of course, Europe was steeped at that time in Christianity. Now, I'm going to answer as many as I can. The answers will not be satisfactory, as I said. When you talk about belief in God, are you speaking about a theistic or deistic model of God? Well, I'm speaking initially about arguments for the existence of an intelligence behind our universe. And many of the arguments I've used tonight could be restricted to deism. But I find deism very inadequate for several very big reasons. And so to answer the question rigorously, I'm speaking about the God of the Bible, who is eternal, who not only created in the sense of inaugurated the universe, but upholds it. And that, I find, makes a lot more sense than the deistic God. Now, I happen to be a Christian, and I haven't mentioned the word Christianity except once in passing, referring to my background. to get more of a concept of God, and I'll come to that in a minute or two probably, I would want to go to other sources of evidence, not science, but to history and experience, which are equally important sources when it comes to answering the bigger questions. But let's leave that for a moment. Here's somebody else defining God as a higher intelligence. Do the rites stroke mumbo jumbo of organized religion help or hinder belief in God for thinking people? Well, they can do both, as you very well know who asked that question. There is a lot of mumbo jumbo, and everything that claims to be Christian is not Christian, and we've got to sort that out. We've got to learn to make distinctions. Let me emphasize again. My life as a scientist is run on an evidence base. What is the evidence for this? And so as a Christian, it's exactly the same. And if I find mumbo jumbo in science, I reject it. And just because mumbo jumbo is put out in the name of God, I reject that as well. We got to think about it and come to our own conclusions. Can mathematics be destroyed? I hope not. I very much hope not. And if not, does this lead us closer to the Word? You see, there's an apposition assumed behind this, that somehow mathematics is in apposition to the Word. Nonsense, it isn't. Mathematics is one of the marvelous expressions of words that describe certain limited aspects of the universe. Einstein's equations, Newton's laws, and so on. They describe certain limited parts of the world. They don't describe the whole world. And so the idea of a mathematical describability of the universe fits in beautifully with a God who reveals himself as the Word. So it's not an apposition at all. That'll have to do for that one. Let's see. Does giving up my atheism necessitate me becoming a Christian? Of course it doesn't. You can become anything you like. If you're going to, the person obviously writing this is a very honest atheist, giving up something, you only give up something if you've good reasons to do so. And therefore, you must decide where the best arguments lead. Now, if you're thinking of giving up your atheism, you must have found something inadequate in it. And I have friends who've given up their atheism. Not to step into a vacuum, because none of us can step into a vacuum. All of us in this room tonight have a worldview. All of us. And it's roughly between three major families: theistic, atheistic, or pantheistic. And perhaps there are some postmodern relativists in the middle, but they usually belong to one of the three as well. So it's a question of evidence-based. Where does the evidence take me? What can I trust? And this is one of the wonderful things about working in a university. You're dealing with young people who are beginning to form their worldview. And all I want to do is not to persuade them to give up whatever they believe, but to put into the pool of their thinking an alternative to the stuff that's being forced at them from every direction. Because as you know, in this country, there's far more atheism in the media than there is talking about God. It's not a level playing field. But encourage them to make up their own minds. So I would say you have to make up your own mind about this. The wonderful thing about Christianity, in my view, is God allows us to make up our own minds. In a universe that doesn't waste energy, minimum states favored, etc., does the fact we can ask the question mean there must be an answer? We ask, is there a God, and therefore there must be. Do you know, I haven't a clue what the answer to that question is. I must be honest, and I'm not sure that I even understand it. What asking questions has to do with energy? Does asking questions involve energy? Do the thought processes? I mean, there's a huge array of assumptions behind this. So let's see that. Do you think God created something from nothing? Ah, well, here's the nothing question. My position on that is this. I had a debate at the Harvard MIT Faculty Club with Alan Guth. I expect the physicists here will know who Alan Guth is. He's one of the world's top astrophysicists, the inventor or discoverer of the theory of inflation. And we had a very interesting public debate, very friendly, but I took the opportunity to ask him a question. I said, Alan, you know, out there in the public, there's much ado about nothing. When you, as an astrophysicist, use the word nothing, are you using it in a philosophical sense in which we all use it, absence of anything? He said, no, we are not. It's a quantum vacuum or something like that, which is manifestly not nothing. And ladies and gentlemen, I must be honest, I've read most of the books about nothing, and I find myself more and more amused, quite honestly. Because listen to this. This is Lawrence Krauss, one of the world's leading astrophysicists. He writes a book called A World from Nothing. And on about page 4, he says this. Because something is physical, nothing must be physical, especially if you define it as the absence of something. What? That is absolute nonsense. And what I discover is they claim to get a universe from nothing. Why is that? Because of the standard model. It's because, well, if you believed in the eternal universe, you'd no problem. But now that you believe that there was nothing at one stage, and now we got a universe, you have to answer the question, how do you get something from nothing? And all, without exception, including Hawking, the examples I have read, don't get a universe from nothing. They get it from something. That's the first thing. The second thing is, to answer the question, the biblical view is very interesting. The universe did not come from nothing, it came from God. It has a cause, but the cause is nothing physical. If I take scripture seriously, which I do, God is spirit. So the universe is created by nothing physical. How that can happen, of course, is a deep mystery. And it's wonderful, the science we try to do. But we're bamboozling ourselves, I think, in a very big way by these redefinitions of nothing. It always troubles me if people have to redefine a perfectly intelligible concept to get their ideas across. We've had two tonight. The first one is faith. For the new atheists, it's belief where there's no evidence. That's blind faith. It isn't faith. Secondly, nothing. So that's all I can say about nothing tonight. I have written a book, God and Stephen Hawking, just a little book, if you were predisposed to look at it. Now, is there more or less faith in the Oxford or Cambridge scientific community? Well, absolutely. Absolutely there is. More or less faith in the Oxford or scientific community. You see, the question shows that you haven't quite been listening. Do you mean faith in God? Or do you mean faith? All of us are people of faith. If I sat each one of you down and said, tell me what you believe, we'd be here until midnight with every single one of you. You're all people of faith. The issue is faith in what? Are there more in Oxford who believe in God than Cambridge? I haven't a notion. But what I do know is that there are many who believe in God, and there are many who believe in atheism. Perhaps I should illustrate just how complex this is and how foolish it can get. I did a debate with Peter Singer. Do you know who Peter Singer is? He's the leading bioethicist in the world. And at the beginning of the lecture, I did precisely what I did with you tonight. I talked about my parents. And when he got the chance to speak, he said, well, there's my biggest objection to religion. People stay in the faith in which they were brought up. So I thought, this is going to be very interesting. So when I got a chance to speak, I said, Peter, I told them about my parents. What about yours? It might be good to level the playing field. Were your parents atheists? He said, yes, they were. Oh, I said, so you remained in the faith in which you were brought up. Oh, but he said, it isn't a faith. Oh, I said, Peter, I'm really sorry. I thought you believed it. Now, at that point, we discovered later cyberspace went wild. Here was one of the world's leading philosophers, and this is what disturbs me. that doesn't realize his atheism is a belief system. Dawkins says atheists have no faith and then writes a big book on what he believes. Christopher Hitchens, even worse. And I got on well with the man. He said, our beliefs are not a belief. Our faith is not a faith. They're wrestling with this notion that they have imbibed, totally falsely, that faith means believing where there's no evidence. And they want to be scientists, so they believe where there is evidence, but then it's not faith, which is just utter confusion and nonsense. And it's completely confused the general public, because I meet it all the time, particularly in the world of science, but not only in the world of science. So where does that get us? Is there more or less faith in Oxford? Well, let's see, how are we doing? We'll leave Oxford behind there, and we leave that behind. I'm going to leave that towards the end. That is logical. Okay. Oxford English Dictionary, that's a good thing to consult. Physicist, a believer in the material origin of the universe. How very interesting. How very interesting. That reminds me of Webster's Dictionary. It's got a new entry. Faith, noun, believing where there's no evidence. Now, this is interesting for many intellectual reasons. Physicist, a believer in the material origin. You see, the interesting thing is this. It's a demarcation kind of definition. When we study the world scientifically, what presuppositions can we have? And some people say, well, they must be materialistic. In other words, you must have a pre-assumed materialistic philosophy. Richard Lewontin, the Harvard geneticist, says that. We accept the results of materialistic thinking about science, even if they're counterintuitive, etc., etc. Why? Because we cannot allow a divine foot in the door. At least that's honest. So what he's saying is that his matrix of presuppositions rules out anything beyond the material. And of course you can do that. You can define a physicist like this if you like, although it's a definition I'm rather intrigued by. You rule out only material. Well, what are you going to do with information if you accept this definition? You're going to run into very serious trouble. Now, there's a huge literature out there. I'm very aware of it because, like Augustine said about time, everybody knows what time is until they try to define it. Everybody knows what science is until you try to define it. But there is no accepted definition of science or physics by that matter. We've all got ideas that are associated with the so-called scientific method, but there's no one scientific method. And so we flounder a bit with things like this. But the point is that if you define a physicist as someone committed to a material origin, you are talking not about their science, but about their philosophy as well. And that's okay. If you say to me, well, I'm committed to materialism, that's fine. But I might ask you for evidence for it. If your science is based on assuming a materialistic worldview, you'll never rise out of that. You'll never consider any other possibility. For example, if I design a machine that can only see visible light, and you come along one day and say, I'm a German, my name is Röntgen, I come from Würzburg. I have discovered something that I've called X-rays. Oh, have you really, Mr. Röntgen? Let me have a look. And I pick up my machine, it can only see visible light, and it doesn't see the X-rays. And I say, therefore, they don't exist. That's what's happening. If you assume a paradigm that cannot see something, it won't see it, by definition. But that doesn't prove it doesn't exist. And therefore, people that assume a paradigm, rather unwisely, I think, that rules out the supernatural. And I don't simply mean miracles. I mean human reason. You see, the argument I've been developing, let me put it into a very strong searchlight, is that human reason, if it's to be valid, is not purely natural. It is the beginnings of evidence of the non-natural or the supernatural. Read C.S. Lewis's book on miracles for more information about that. But that is a very interesting thing. I shall think about it. Right. Now, these are questions that are not relevant to the talk, and I'll have to keep those if I'm going to keep faith with people. Let's see these. There are, believe it or not, several questions on the age of the earth. And there is a question about Francis Collins. Let me see if I can find it. Do you concur with Francis Collins that God had a hand in the evolutionary process, or that the Genesis 1 account was literal? Wow, how much time have we got? Well, first of all, let me say that I count Francis Collins as a friend. And I have met him on several occasions, read his books, and so on. Now, the question here says, do you concur with Francis Collins that God had a hand in the evolutionary process? Certainly, in as far as the evolutionary process does anything. You see, the assumption behind the question is that life, human life, say, has come about by an evolutionary process. But now, what does that mean? Is it guided or is it not guided? Francis Collins is one of those people that doesn't agree with Richard Dawkins. Richard Dawkins says it's unguided, a naturalistic, unguided process. Collins rejects that. But now comes the great difficulty in descriptors. Is it right to call a guided process evolution when most of the world believes evolution is a non-guided process? There's a huge amount to discuss in here, which I can't begin to go into tonight. But let's just suppose for a moment that evolution does something. It obviously does. Charles Darwin saw that it did. The question is, how much does it do? And the big question I see being debated, and I'm not a biologist, though I go to biology seminars and read lots of the stuff because it fascinates me, how much does the mechanism of, say, mutation, genetic drift, and natural selection, how much does it actually support? Is it creative? Does it generate new information? Now, as far as I can see, there's great division in the scientific world about that. But one of the things that's bedeviled the whole discussion, ladies and gentlemen, is this, that the origin of life has nothing to do with evolution. For years, Richard Dawkins' book, The Blind Watchmaker, was the textbook. The blind automatic process, natural selection, which Darwin discovered, is the explanation for the existence and variation of all of life. Dawkins has, after all these years, retracted the first part of that for a simple logical reason. If you're going to have evolution of any kind, you've got to have life to start with. So you cannot use evolution to explain the origin of life. And that's a greater mystery than it was in 1953 when the Nobel Prize was won by Miller and Urey because they thought they'd found the answer. Now, these are hugely deep questions. And I'm a mathematician, so I come to this with a lot of skepticism, especially when it comes to the idea that information can originate without mental input, without mind. And what I think, in light of the definition of a physicist here, I would like to be much more open to, and I notice that people are beginning to be much more open to it, to the idea that all causation is not bottom-up. There is real top-down causation. But of course, the moment you admit that, you've got to ask, what is the top? Where is the causation coming from? So, inasmuch as evolution does something, of course I see the hand of God in it, that it can support all the weight that we put on it, I'm not so sure. But that leads me into this. Is the Genesis 1 account literal? Now, this I get as a question very frequently, ladies and gentlemen. Do you take the Bible literally? Nobody does. Jesus said, I am the door. Do you take that literally? Well, of course not. You take it metaphorically. Yes? take the very opening chapter, Genesis 1, and God said, what does that mean? As an astrophysicist once said to me, come on, he said, do you mean to tell me that God has a voice box and lungs like we've got, and God said? Now, we read that, we often don't think about it. Does it mean that God spoke in some language, there's nobody there to listen, according to Genesis? What do we mean by God speaking? We haven't a clue. Because if God is a spirit and hasn't got a voice box and lungs, we have to remove some of the aspects of what the word said conveys to us and leave others. It's just the same as when the Bible calls God Father. It's not talking about a biological sense. We instantly understand that. So we have to drop some of the biology and fit it in. What I'm saying is this, the Bible, like any other literature, is full of metaphor. We need to grasp that, otherwise we're in danger of being very foolish with the Bible. Let me give you an example of that. I was asked this question once when I was traveling, and do you take the Bible literally? And I said, when somebody like you asks me a question like that, I say, Israel was a land flowing with milk and honey. So when the Israelites came into the country, they met a big sticky mess of honey and milk coming bowling down the main street. And he laughed at me. He said, of course it doesn't mean that. Oh no, I said, it probably means Israel was a land full of the milk of the word and the honey of the Holy Spirit. And he looked at me as if I was crazy. And I said, they're both crazy. Israel was a land, that's literal. The milk and honey were literal. The metaphor is in the word flowing. Now, we use that all the time. I saw my friend Jim yesterday flying down the street in his Jaguar. Well, do you take that literally? Now, think before you answer. You don't take it spiritually. You don't take it allegorically. You take it metaphorically. Now, here's the point. And C.S. Lewis, mercifully, I learned this when I was at school, and it saved me from many disasters. Lewis makes the point, you use a metaphor to describe something real. In other words, you're describing real fast motion, but you're using a metaphor to describe it. So when, for instance, Jesus said, I am the door, he didn't mean one of those. But he meant he was a real doorway into a spiritual experience of God. That is, it's literal at the next level up. So what's the problem? The word literal is useless. It is useless. But now let me address this question here. What do I think about the age of the earth? Well, this is the point where people put on their seatbelts and expect me to say, because I didn't tell you this before, you see. I come from Armagh in Northern Ireland. Does that ring any bells? Archbishop Usher, who wrote to the Vice-Chancellor of Cambridge, dear sir, Adam was born on the 4th of September, was it 4004 BC? I'm sorry, I can't date it more accurately. So I come from that part of the world. What do I believe about the age of the earth? Well, as far as I understand, the most recent physics tells us about 4 billion years old. I have no difficulty with that. Why? Because now here, this might shock some of you, and if so, pardon me. I don't think the Bible says anything about the age of the earth at all. Let me prove that to you very simply. The Bible starts with the words, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And then it lists a series of days, the first day, the second, and so on. And there you are, people say, the beginning wasn't day one. No, it wasn't. The sequence of days follows the initial statement. Not only that, but my friends who are Hebrew scholars tell me quite clearly that the first introductory two verses of Genesis are in one past tense, and the sequence of days are in another past tense, which tells them what? That the initial statement, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, precedes the sequence of days. By how long? The text doesn't say, so neither do I. Isn't it interesting? No matter what you believe about the days, and let me do a bit of shameless advertising, I've written a book about them, but no matter what you believe about them, they don't tell you anything about the age of the earth. So I'm quite happy to derive it from my friends who are physicists and who tell me about these things. Now, I'm well aware that they may change their mind by a few million years. That's fine. That's fine. But you see, ladies and gentlemen, what lies behind all this is, I am completely convinced of the authority of Scripture, but I'm not prepared to defend it by going beyond what it says. Because that only gets it into disrepute. And the sight of professing Christians arguing about the age of the earth, when out in the outside world, nobody is remotely interested in it, because they simply accept what the best science of the day reveals to them, I think is an absolute tragedy. Because these things are not essential to the biblical revelation about God. Now, I'm going to finish so that we can get out by 9 o'clock. And there are just a couple more things. Did you ever want proof of God as real? And did you ever think that the Bible was just a story? That's a very perceptive question. Did you ever want proof of God as real? Absolutely. Absolutely. Did you ever think it was just a story? Rephrasing that is, did you ever have doubts? Yes, constantly and every day, and I've spent my whole life articulating them. You see, ladies and gentlemen, when we raise the word doubt, people often think of one thing, the black hole of doubt, where the whole world seems to be falling apart and all this kind of thing. But doubt is just the flip side of faith. It's asking questions. And the reason my convictions in the direction of Christianity are so strong is I've spent my entire life subjecting them all repeatedly and endlessly to extremely critical examination by some of the most powerful antagonists in the world. That's what convinces me of the truth of Christianity. It stands up to objections. Now, did I ever want proof that God is real? Of course. I was, I think, in the States at a big university, and a student stood up and said, "You're a Christian, you're a scientist." He was being very generous. And look, that's impossible, because you see, in science, we believe in testability. Christianity is not testable. And I never heard it put in that way before. But my response was instant. I said, "Who told you that? Of course it's testable. I wouldn't be a Christian for a nanosecond if it wasn't testable." Well, what does that mean? Well, ladies and gentlemen, I said at the beginning, this gets you so far. But it doesn't get you the whole way, because we are human beings. We're not desiccated scientific intellects, although science is very important. We are human beings, and we search constantly for meaning. We may find part of it in our science, but if we find all of it in our science, we'll be left frustrated, because life is bigger than that. We are persons. We are made for relationships. And the biblical claim is that it is possible to have a relationship with God. Now, that's a huge claim. And the mechanism for that is equally stupendous. Because, you see, I have talked about the Word. In the beginning was the Word. That's the first big thing, to recognize there's a Word behind this universe. The even bigger thing is this: and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Well, that's stupendous. If it's true. Of course, if it's not true, it's crazy. But Jesus of Nazareth claims to be the one who invented the atom. That'll focus it in your mind. And the magnificently complex things you study, he claims to be the truth. Not to say merely true things, but be the truth behind them. How would you test that? Well, there are many ways of testing that. First of all, does it cog into history and make sense? And one of the reasons I stand before you as a Christian is because I believe, historically, that Jesus rose from the dead. That death is not the end. Now, if you wanted me to give evidence for that, that would be another lecture, so I can't do it. Another reason is this. Christ makes certain claims, and they're very profound claims. He claims to be able to deal with problems that affect every one of us. Guilt, for instance, making a mess of our lives and other people's lives. He claims to be able to transform life. He claims to be able to bring peace into our lives, to forgive us. We all know what these things mean. He claims to give us new energy and a new start if we're prepared. And now it comes. How can you test it? Well, he says, if you're prepared to agree with me about what's wrong with you and repent of it and trust me as Savior and Lord, then you will receive peace with God, a new life, forgiveness of sins. You can test that, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, I wouldn't stand here for a moment if I hadn't seen it work in my own life and in the lives of thousands of people. I was in Harvard some time ago, and when I'd finished a lecture like this, a Chinese man stood up in the balcony, a student, and he shouted to all of us. He said, "Just look at me." And of course, we all looked. And he was speaking to me. He was just up there. I said, "Why should we look at you?" He said, "Just look at me." And he was radiant with happiness and peace and everything else. He said, 6 months ago, I was at the end. My life was in a complete mess. I couldn't see any way out. And somebody brought me to hear one of your lectures, and something you said made me go back and open a Bible and start to look. And he said, not long after that, and people express this in different ways, I came to trust in Christ, I met Jesus Christ, and he said, "Just look at me." And you know, everybody could see this is utter and obvious transformation. Now, when you see that again and again, as I have done, then it adds to this. This is intellectual argument. It is very important to my mind. I don't want to be fooled. But I'm a human being. I have needs that go way beyond the satisfaction of my intellectual curiosity. I have needs for relationship, for friendship, for real peace. And what about the huge problems? I wish I had time to begin to go into them. Like the problem of evil and suffering. Are there any answers to problems like that? Well, there are no simplistic answers, but there are ways in. And if you want to pursue that, just let me mention, if I may, there's one little book I've written called Gunning for God that deals with that side of it. The first book I wrote was God's Undertaker, A Science Buried God. That's about this kind of stuff. But then I could see there's a much deeper need out there in society is to go beyond this. And so that's why I did that. But now it is time to go to bed. So thank you very much indeed.
Just a few closing comments and notices. I'm Jonathan Moby, the rector of Harwell and Chilton Churches. Thank you so much for coming and for being an amazing audience and great questions. Just a few other thank yous as well. Thank you to Karina for coordinating an amazing event and the others on her team who've helped to do that. I've done very little and she's done nearly all of it, so that's brilliant. Just wanted to say there are books, some of John's books, available on a stand at the back if you do fancy picking up any of those, or buying them rather. And you can also find them online if you do want to consider at more length. There's also some literature about some other things going on, and you'll probably be given a flyer on the way out as well about the next talk in this series, which is going to be in February, from a biologist this time. So we've touched on biology, and we're going to continue along the biological route. But want to conclude by thanking Professor Lennox for a very entertaining and stimulating talk, stretched our brains, or should I say minds. That's a thing I'm going to be thinking more about, the issue of consciousness. But it's been a very stimulating evening, and I just want us to have one more opportunity to give a further round of applause before we all go home. But thank you very much.